And I believe that's a total testimony of what it is that we focus on. And I think it is because we don't know any better and we need guidance for somebody to help us. Because who wouldn't want to get their family back? Who wouldn't want to fight to get their finances back? Who wouldn't want to get back to where they were? I don't know if there's anything wrong with that. But if you get where you think you need to go and nothing's changed on the inside of you, wherever you go, there you are, and you're going to be the same person it is. And we realize that the steps of AA, the steps of NA, the steps of CMA, the steps of GA, the steps of SA, or whatever A your A is, I got them all covered. But the thing is that the only step that deals with addiction is the first step. And then it's all emotional, it's dealing with your past, it helps you with your present, it helps you with your future. And you know how I speak when I speak. I mean, you want to get to a place in life where your past is forgiven, your present has meaning, and your future is secure. Now, what a way to live your life. You literally, no matter how many mistakes you've made, no matter how many disappointments you've had, no matter how many unbroken promises you've lived, broken promises you've lived, that God is still who He says He is. I went to the women's house meeting last night and I began, Janice asked me a question on, you know, let me pray first. Lord, I thank you for another day above ground and out of prison. Lord, I thank you for breath in my lungs and the ability to see with my eyes. Lord, I thank you for 120% respiration and everything that my addiction stole from me. Lord, I thank you for the identity I have in you, Lord. I thank you for friends like this. Lord, I ask you to remove me from this building that it may be you speaking and not me. Lord, I ask that you change lives tonight. That you soften hearts and open minds and begin to plant and root people to know that they were brought here for a reason. And the reason is to learn how to help other people. And when you learn how to help other people, you're helping yourself. And that's why you saved us. That's why you brought us out of the bar. That's why you brought us out of the dope house. To learn how to help other people on your behalf. Because I've learned how you operate, God. You cannot keep what you have unless you give it away. In your name we pray, amen. So Janice was talking to me, and before Monica and I left on our trip, I had talked about being planted. And I really think from listening to you guys and hearing conversations is the fact that it's beginning to resonate in you that what does it really mean? You're doing some self-examination. Am I planted? Am I not planted? And Janice had asked me a question because a couple weeks ago I had said, you know, we're all in the same ground. We're all hearing the same teaching. We're doing, for the most part, the same things. Now, some people are and some people aren't. But all of us in the program are going to Sunday and Tuesday and some on Wednesday. So we're hearing the same information. Why are some growing and flourishing while others aren't? Because God says that He doesn't play favorites. He said He is no respecter of persons. He proves to us in His Word that He'll take the worst of the worst and turn them into the best of the best. Why would God want to do that? Because He can show off through you how powerful He really is. Because when people see you changed, it's going to be hard for them to say that there isn't a God.
Right.
You've been called to change the skeptics. You've been called, and the greatest scripture you could ever preach is to close your mouth and live your life.
Right. Right.
People don't watch what you say, they watch what you do.
That's right.
And that's what I love about this environment is you can feel the vibe here, you can feel the love. Even for the most guarded wall, you got to understand, when you have walls up around you, you think they're walls of protection, you fail to recognize those are the walls that are imprisoning you. So as Janice asked me that question, why is this? And the Bible's very clear. And Jack and I were talking about this last night at about midnight. It's discouraging when you see people not wanting to grow. You see people want to do it their way. But the Bible is very clear when it says, one waters, one plants, and it's only God that makes them grow. So when Janice asked that question, I began to meditate later on in the evening. Why are some growing and some aren't? I believe only God knows our motives. Only God knows why you're really here. We can say whatever we want to say. You know we can tell people what they want to hear. But if you're just worried about the outside, you're that talented, you'll get it back. But will you keep it? I couldn't keep it. I mean, addicts and alcoholics are some of the most talented people I've ever met in my life. Last night in this particular meeting, we talked about the characteristic or character trait of longing for something. See, when you long for your alcohol, or you long for your drug, or you long for your casino, or longing for sex, whatever it is, I mean, that is a gift, a character trait that God gave you that has been misdirected to the wrong thing. If you rechannel the longing for Him, He'll take care of everything you need. So don't think that there's something wrong with you. You are just very good at longing for something. Now, nobody longs for the stuff like we long for it. So be grateful that you have that in your spirit. Just learn to channel it differently. Channel it differently, and I'll circle back on it for a second here too, is the fact that, you know, to answer your question, Janice, is that God will not grow somebody that where He knows their motives are wrong. It will always be revealed why you're here. And that's the title of tonight's message. What are you doing here? Are you here to get your family back? Well, you've done that before and lost them again. Are you here to beat the courts? Are you here to get your finances back? I mean, are you here to get free? Because if you're here to get free, you can get free. But there's conditions to the soil. If you're planted here, there's ways to operate. It isn't your way, it isn't my way, it's the way. That's why AA says, and how it works, that half measures avail us nothing. Now it also references in how it works, it says that you need to have rigorous honesty. I always thought that meant that I couldn't lie to you. What that means is don't lie to yourself. Because if you can lie to yourself, you will have no problem lying to anybody else. You will convince yourself and your loved ones or your employers or the judge why you don't have to work it the way it's supposed to be worked. And you might even convince them. We are some of the best salespeople there are on the planet. One thing I learned about us and all the people I used to manipulate is they weren't in the jail cell with me. They didn't come into treatment with me when I had my bag when I left the hotel room. For those of you who don't know, my father, who's here tonight, used to have to hire private investigators to find me on the streets. He gave Brett a stack of money to take to the pond. I mean, Brett and I used to run together. And there's people that I used to run. I mean, but God recycles all this and brings us all back together. See, there's no more better fulfillment than I've had in my life. No business deal, no goal I scored, no. Not even, you know, I love my kids. I mean, they're unbelievable. They're everything to me. But when you can help somebody change their life, but you're not God and nor am I. Only God can make them grow. You can water them. You can encourage them. You can hold them accountable. But I'm here to tell you, people, don't get frustrated when they don't do what's suggested for them to do. It's painful, but there's a principle in the Bible called reaping and sowing. The same feeling that your family members had about you, you're going to learn to have about other people. Because you're going to have to feel the pain that they went through now when you're trying to help somebody and they just don't want to do it. Same thing you put your family through, same thing that I put my family through. So in Haggai 1:6 it says, what have been the results of your life? It says in verse 6, you have planted much and harvested little. Now there I was at 35 years old, and everything I had got kicked out of my house, going through a divorce, everything was in a plastic bag out of a hotel room. That was it. I had worked, I graduated college, I had worked and had my own company, but when it was all said and done, I had nothing but consequences. Horvath taught me all this a long time ago. You don't know how much you need God until God is all you've got. So if God is all you've got right now, see, I got a buddy in prison that I went to high school with. He's trying to get me to come see him, and they finally got me approved as a chaplain to go see him. And one thing I've watched him in years, he's one of the best salespeople I've ever met in my life. I played hockey with his brother, he's a great guy. You know, I actually married him in my living room. It was the most bizarre thing I've ever seen in my life. That was not when I was less mature than I am now. But the thing is that happened as I watch him is every time he gets out of treatment, every time he gets out of prison, he goes back to the same profession. He sells roofs. He makes hundreds of thousands of dollars. There's nothing that he can possibly do to get fired from that job. That's why I never listened to him. I always went back to my old profession after treatment, and there was no accountability until this last time I took the job, taking 1/20th of what I was used to making, and it was a 9-to-5 that I had to be there, because I didn't know what discipline was. I didn't know what structure was. And what it's saying here is that you have planted much. We've all done a lot, but when it was all said and done, when we hit the pavement called rock bottom in our addiction, what did we really have? Another thing that I found myself thinking as I got put in check in my last treatment is I went into treatment and I said, well, I got a house in Plymouth. I got my own company. The guy said, brother, the only thing you got is a crack habit. That's it. Don't tell me you got some house in Plymouth that you haven't been in 6 months. Don't tell me you got a company. If you showed up there, they'd think that you had either lost 120 pounds or something's going on. They wouldn't even recognize you. You got a crack habit, and if you don't deal with this, it will continue to deal with you. But left to my own devices, left to my own thinking, I'm going to continually repeat it. That's why the program teaches us what's insanity. Doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. I got to change one thing, that's everything. I got to change everything. You know, you hear me say this, I mean, because I come from the business world, I think I got all this talent. I'm a liability to this day. You know how much my health insurance, life insurance costs? They barely would insure a guy like me. Just because we got a resume, does your resume say character on it? Does your resume say finisher on it? I might have a lot of accomplishments, but the Bible is right about me. You have planted much, but you've harvested little. You eat, but you're never satisfied. You drink, but you're still thirsty. You put on clothes, but you cannot keep warm. Your wages disappear as though you were putting in pockets filled with holes. Now, this just doesn't speak to the person that loses everything because of their addiction. It also speaks to the person that might have something that is still miserable. It's because you got money and you're miserable. I had the white picket fence. I had the dog running around in the backyard. I was miserable. What do we know about misery? Misery doesn't love company, it demands company. They don't ever listen to them when they say the addict's out in the parking lot doing push-ups. No, the addict's sitting on your shoulder doing it, ready to do something. That's why the Bible says, be self-controlled and alert. The devil, the enemy, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for somebody to devour. I got devoured time and time again. So it's speaking also that I was addicted to the chase. Who would be addicted for staying up for a week? Who would be addicted for spending all your money in a casino? Who would be addicted to puking your guts up? You're addicted to the chase. And you're preoccupied with it. Ezekiel 17:5, who and what planted you at SB? He also took a seedling from the land. So, you got to understand that something, a circumstance or a person, planted you here. Could have been a judge, could have been a family member, could have been a treatment center recommendation, but something other than you planted you here, and that's a good thing. It says planted in fertile soil. See, I've been planted in the wrong places. Now, if you look at why we relapse, we leave where we've been planted. Why do addicts and alcoholics relapse? They stop going to meetings. They remove themselves where God planted them, or people suggested for them to plant it. And then it says, beside a broad river where it could grow. I mean, I don't want to just exist in my life. I want to continue to grow. With God, there are no limits. With me, I'm full of limits. But with God, as you see in this program, you see in the church, you see in the favor that's connected here, that there are no limits to what you can do through Him. And if He can get it through you, He'll continue to get it to you. Can God get it through you to help another person? And that's why we're here. It says in Amos 9:15, how firm were you planted when you went down? It says, I will firmly plant them there in their own land. See, I mean, that's why I love it when people call living in these homes, it's actually their home. It's not a place that they're going to be for 30 days. If you put a timeline on this right now, you might as well leave now. Because it's your timeline. When has your timeline worked? How firmly were you planted? You got to understand, when you went down, when you relapsed, when you lost everything, you were planted. You weren't buried. Don't act if you were buried, because if you think you're buried tonight because of your circumstances, all you're going to do is waste all your energy to get back up to the surface that wasn't that good at the beginning. There's a couple different people that I've seen when they get planted. There's two types of addicts. When I was planted, when I used drugs and alcohol, here's what happens. I go down quick. I wouldn't want to be one of these people. It goes like this. It takes some years to get planted. Treading water, still going to work. Well, they slowly lose everything. I would much rather be this guy that falls quickly than a person that goes out and before they get planted, they got to live 6 months or 2 years or whatever. So how firmly were you planted? How bad was it really? What it's saying here is they will never again be uprooted. This is my wife and I's life now. I'm not worried about the next chase or the next job or the next thing we're going to buy or the next thing we're going to drive. No, this is it for me. See, I'm the type of guy that I never was satisfied with one woman. I go from woman to woman, job to job, this to that, and everything else. But sometimes we're planted in the wrong thing. See, I want you to know that you can be planted. Let's refer to your addiction for a second. When you were planted in your addiction and they dragged you out of there, you ran back to where you were planted. When they kicked you out of the bar, you went back anyway. When you owed the dope fuel or the money, you were planted with that guy or gal. You went back and asked for more even though you had nothing. So we know what it's like to be planted. We just have been planted in the wrong things. And what it's saying here now, that I don't want to be uprooted. I don't want to have to rebuild the rest of my life. I want to learn how to build from the land I have given you. Do we understand that recovery is a gift? See, when I got here, not many people were like, oh, we're standing in line to help Jeff. I don't know if I want to choose from 100 people that are trying to help me. There was very few that would accept me. Because I burned bridges. So we got to understand that God plants you in a land that he gives you. And it says now in Ezekiel 36:9, being plowed was a necessity for you to be planted. See, I care about you. I'm paying attention to you. So I don't care where you're at with God tonight. You got to understand that he cares about you. How are you even alive? How did you make it out? I wasn't with you. You weren't with me, but it was pretty bad. We had a recent death of an overdose. Gina's parents are here tonight, and I'm always going to keep her memory alive. She was a really close person to me. She died in her addiction. How are you alive? Why did God salvage you? Why aren't you dead? There's a reason. Because he's got a plan for you. And my plan with him is to keep Gina's legacy alive. And I can go name by name and tell you all the people we have buried in 9 years. But that ain't going to stop a drug addict like me. I thought when my children were born I'd stop using. If you were to ask this champion right here, he's in my small group. He came to this meeting not because he's an addict, because his dad was. And he shares openly what it's like to be a child of an addict. What it's like to watch, you know, things be done. I mean, and I've learned more from him. I want you to know that. I've learned a lot from you. Let's give him a hand. Because addiction or alcoholism or whatever your thing is, it just doesn't affect. saying that to condemn you or shame you or whatever. I might have did it, but I'm not it. I'm not proud of the things I did, but I have no regrets. It made me who I am today. It made me who I am today. And what it's saying here is the fact that God cares about you. He paid attention to you. Because I'm asking you, how are you even here if he didn't care about you and he didn't pay attention to you? I said this on Sunday. You were a winner before you were born. Your sperm beat out the millions of other sperms that were trying to get to your mother's egg. You won before you were born. You have zest. You have determination in that seed. What it's saying here now, in John 4:38, 10 years of work has gone into where you're planted. I sent you to harvest where you didn't plant. Others have already done the work. And now you will get to gather your harvest. See, isn't it something? I'd rather gather than lose. Every one of these paper clips on this Bible is from a message that has been taught in the last 12 months. Both sides. You didn't do the work, but you can benefit from it. Don't you want to be one of those people that people can benefit from you? If you stay where you're planted, people can benefit from you. We've had thousands of addicts and alcoholics go through here in 10 years. It's been tested, tried. We're not perfect, but the results speak for themselves. And I say that with humility because it's all God. But you've been planted in a place that is proven. You've been planted in a place where the work's already been done. You've been planted in a place where the experience has been tested and tried and the fruit is heavy. Don't you want to be around people that got the t-shirt to prove it? Don't you? Would you rather be around a people that don't have a clue? And what it's saying here in Mark 4:31, 10 years later, we are the largest program in it. And that's all to God's glory. If it was up to me, everything we have would be in the pawn shop. You got to understand, that's how I roll. Do I still think about getting high? Yes, I do. But God has removed the desire. And if you're an addict and you tell me you don't, you ain't thinking about quitting once in a while. You ain't thinking about running back to where you came from. You're not saying the big you-know-what you to the world, shutting everybody up. There's nothing wrong with you for thinking about that. What's wrong is if you don't tell somebody about it. Because I can relate to it. And I'm a pastor. When you start turning in the right direction, the wrong direction will call your name. You really need to start thinking about this and getting real with yourself, because it's like a mustard seed planted in the ground. It's the smallest of all seeds. 10 years ago, I had nothing. I couldn't do anything. When this program, when God put it on my heart to start this program, I couldn't see my kids without them taking DNA samples out of my hair. When they finally let me see them, I had to have supervised visits. You talk about humility. But somebody said, don't pay attention to that, just stay focused. Did I see that we would have 8 homes in an apartment complex full of champions? No. But somebody told me, just as said, God's going to do something, you just stay out of the way. And it says, it becomes the largest of all garden plants. See, I mean, you know, we want it now. We don't want to wait for stuff. And it says, it grows long branches, birds can make their nets in the shade. It says in Galatians 6:7, you were planted to undo what has been done. I was talking to the women last night, and you know, I think it was Janice again. This is good stuff. She says, well, I just got to learn how to live. I said, before you learn how to live, you've got to unlearn some things. You have to unlearn and undo what has been done. That's why the steps are in place. That's why the 4th step says, made a searching and fearless moral inventory of myself, not of you. Admitting to God, myself, and another human being, the 5th step says, the exact nature of my wrongs.
The sixth step says becoming entirely ready to have God remove my defects of character. My addiction is a character issue. Seventh step says humbly ask God to remove, not me to remove. I tried to be a better person. I can't do it in my own power. Humbly ask God to remove my shortcomings. Not your shortcomings. My shortcomings. I'm good at pointing out your shortcomings. I heard it in a sermon today when I was in the gym. And he was talking about unity and how it is that you will never have unity with people until you have unity with God. We can put a smile on our face while we're ready to snap in our mind and still think we're doing the right thing. It ain't no way to live. And if you're living like that, you've got this thing called addiction. And that's why it says in Galatians, don't be misled. You cannot mock the justice of God. What are the conditions? Why are you here? You will always harvest what you plant. That's why instead of being planted, we think we're buried and we're harvesting the consequences of our addiction in our choices, and we just want to make right to everything that's being wrong. But the problem that happens is that we're trying to make right and we're not letting God do it. If you step away from your family, let God work on them, well, where you work on you, when you're finally ready to go back, it'll all work out. I manipulated myself back in so many times after treatment. I can't be away from the kids another minute just to leave 3 months later and go into another addiction cycle. What's harder on my children? Watching me do good and not be with me? See, you're going to have to face pain either way. There's times I can't go to my son's baseball game. That's painful for him and I because I got Tuesday night. But it's not the type of pain that he would have to see me walking or talking to him through glass or on my gravesite. I'd rather have him face the pain of me not being at the baseball game than the pain of me being dead. Either way, there's going to be pain. And that's what we've got to realize within ourselves, and that's what it's saying here. See, don't worry about that you're harvesting, you've got all these consequences. Let God work it out. You have a responsibility in that, but it won't be the one you think it is. I harvested this, I had nothing, and he's taking me. I'm still harvesting stuff that I did 10 years ago. People still have a hard time trusting me, but I'm okay with that. But don't worry about everything that's going on. God planted you here for a reason. And it says in James 1:21, you were planted to weed out what has held you back. What do you need to stop doing? And what do you need to start doing? See, that's why the Bible's saying here, where you're planted, you've got to get rid of the filth and evil in your life. If you're a dope fiend, and the only thing that's out of your life is dope, and you're still a fiend, there's something wrong. If the ism of alcohol's got you, the ism of alcohol is what steps 2 through 12 deal with. Steps 2 through 12 don't deal with alcohol. I'll go big book with anybody. Or God will stand right next to me. I love the big book. I love the NA It Works How and Why. I love the basic text. I love the GA book. And I didn't have a problem with gambling. And I guess I did. My whole life was a gamble. Every time I woke up, it was a gamble. But what it's saying here is you've got to get rid of some things where you're planted in order to grow. Humbly accept the word of God that God has planted in your hearts. This is the only way it's going to get better. And it says, for it has the power to save your souls. See, a lot of us look to God we look for God for His power to save us from our circumstances. That's not what the Bible says. It has the power to save your soul, not your circumstance. Sometimes God allows that painful circumstance to keep you in check. If everything had vanished day one of sobriety, would you even work a program? You wouldn't. See, when you've got to work to get it back, maybe you won't lose it. And that's what it's saying here. It says in Psalm 126, 5 and 6, you were planted in order to... See, you got to cry before you can fly. I didn't even think I had tear ducts. I can cry now if the sun's shining. My wife and I sit in bed and cry how great God is. He came back 3 years ago from a gambling episode. See, him and I ran together for many years in recovery. We're chronic relapsers. So I had dinner with him at Papa's down the street, and he said, give me $100 to fill my tank. I said, I ain't giving you nothing. You're going to feel this one. You need to cry. You need to realize what you just did. What gave you permission? So you need to cry before you fly it. And that's what it's saying here. It's so important to understand. Those who plant in tears will harvest with shouts of joy. Those who weep will go to plant the seed. But they sing. So, I mean, I'm grateful that I was able to release that thing through tears. Matthew 6:26. You were planted to learn your value. See, a lot of people look at God like, God isn't going to do these things for me. I have to do them for myself. Look at the birds. The Bible says they don't plant or harvest or store food in barns. For your heavenly Father feeds them. Aren't you more valuable to them? See, sometimes I get a little twisted. My cat is on dialysis. I don't think they give me dialysis. Insulin. I'm like, this cat gets more attention than me. But that cat ain't going to save a soul. I mean, there's animals that help people. Those animals help me. But when it comes to getting somebody into heaven, See, the thing is that you don't think that God's going to take care of you. So you want to go do all the work that is intended for Him. You think that I got you. The I got yous is what got you in trouble. We have to. We is all over the 12 steps. And what it's saying here, and it's so important, 2 Corinthians 9:6, you were planted to go all in. Remember this, a farmer who plants only a few seeds, I mean, you're going to pick and choose your smorgasbord of recovery. I'm willing to do this, but I'm not willing to do that. Did you say I was willing to drink vodka and not bourbon? Were you willing just to have beer because alcohol got... I'm going to snort, but I'm not going to get it. I'm going to swallow versus I'm going to shoot. I mean, what? I mean, you crossed every line there. So you got to understand, you got to take full advantage of what God is doing here, because the one who plants generously will get a generous cup. See, we have so many results around here, I can't even enjoy the blessings, because there's too much work to do. I saw my dad, who hired this, you know, I had a 35-year-old babysitter. You met him on Sunday. Ex-gang member from Chicago, lived in Plymouth. They hired him to babysit me. And I thought I was pulling a fast one on him, I'd be out in the garage. Yeah, what I was doing out in the garage. Every time I came in, I had a different, I'm fixing this, I'm doing that. Well, that's good. Amazed me on these stories I came up with. But I saw tears in my dad's eye when he saw full circle what God can do. From when he was sitting with me as a babysitter at 35 to what God has done in 10 years. And he can do the same thing for you. I'm part of that story. Respect character, he doesn't play favors. And what it's saying here is so true, because it's like, you know, you got to understand that you got to be generous. I mean, you know, get fully involved in your recovery. John 12:24, you were planted to learn how to help people. I tell you the truth, unless a kernel of wheat is planted and soil dies, it remains alone. You shouldn't feel alone in this family. The reason why you feel alone is because you're not letting anybody else in. You need to put yourself out there just like you did in your addiction. Just like when we did it when we woke up and we don't know who was sleeping next to us. Just like when we ingested drugs when we didn't know where they came from. Just like when we got behind the wheel drunk out of our minds and didn't know where we were going. See, I think that, and then I speak your language. It's my language too. Somebody needs to remind me of that. Somebody needs, and what you heard me say this on Sunday, when it's not about you, you will change lives. When I ended, this program began. Where you end, God begins. Matthew 15:13-14. When planted, stay away from people that aren't planted. Why is it that we want what we can't have? I deal with this with men and women sometimes. Here, you can't date these 10 people. There's 20 million people. Just stay away from these 10. And every time the 10 walk by, they're like this. It's like, I mean, it's what God is. Why would you want to be around a person that has nothing for you? Two minuses in this case don't make a plus. That is not your future husband. It is not your future wife. And what it's saying here is, as we're planted, and this is what the Bible is saying, it says, Jesus replied, every plant not planted to my heavenly Father will be uprooted. People that aren't here for the right reasons, God will take care of them like that. So a lot of times, I don't have to do a thing. I just step back and let God do his thing. Don't let them, here's what the Bible says. It says, ignore them. See, if you can learn to ignore that, then you can ignore everything else they're saying. You don't even know who they is. Our whole lives we paid attention to what they said. Who is they? And that's what it's saying here. It's saying ignore them. They are like the blind guides leading the blind. If one blind person guides another, they will both fall into the ditch. And here's how I used to operate. Here's how I deal with people in recovery. Is they come to you when they've been planted. I got a group of guys, these guys that do the parking lot here on Sunday nights, they are flourishing, they all look healthy, they're of service, they're laughing. If they stay planted, this is what their life's going to look like. But a lot of people don't. But it's like, you know, I mean, who's leading you? It's a, you know, and this is how it works, with God and people that are here to help you. You go to them when you're down, you ask them how to live, they you want them to help you with their mess. They want you to help them, and then what happens is, they get back on their feet again, they totally disregard you, and then they fall flat on their face and come back to you and say, now what do you want me to do? That was me for many years. But at least somebody's saying, now what do you want me to do? But that's how we have to live our life. Don't be around people that don't have anything that you want. Don't be intimidated by people that have something that you want. You'll never rise above the company you keep. If you're the smartest person in the room, you're in the wrong room. Get around people that will challenge you. Get around people that will correct you. If somebody cares enough to correct you, not co-sign you. Ecclesiastes, when planted, take the work out. I mean, what do you know about the word? I got issues. Issue. You're the issue. I'm the issue. Ish you. When the issue is you, you got issues with everybody but you. When you're pointing the finger at somebody else, how many are pointing back at you? And what it's saying here, it's so important. Farmers who wait for perfect weather never plant. They watch every crop. I'll go to meetings when I get my bank account straightened out. I'll go to meetings when. I'll pray when. I'll when I have more time. But did you have that type of direction from your addiction? Or did you use when you didn't want to use? Did you not show up to work when you said you were going to be there? Did you pick the kids up? See, you did not listen that way to your addiction. You did whatever the addiction told you to do. So you can do it. You can do it. And it says in Luke 13:6, the time has come to stop being a disappointment. I don't want to be a disappointment to myself or others anymore. Jack and I were talking about that last night. It's like, man, it's disappointing when people are not grasping this. But I'm sure they said the same thing about me back in the day. It was my choice. Same ground, same teaching, same people. And what I'm saying, so I ask you as we close, where are you at tonight in your recovery? It says in Psalm 1:3, are you planted? Can you wait for the miracle? It says they are like trees planted along the riverbank, bearing fruit in each season. See, we can't wait for God. We want to make it happen. We want to force the results. If God, here's one thing, I talked to the women about this last night. You know, you think it's painful waiting for something? What's more painful, waiting or getting it and you force it to happen and losing it again? Either way, there's going to be pain. I'd rather wait and know it's coming. then get it and lose it again. God will never give you anything prematurely. He's never early. He's never late. He's always on time. Can you wait for Him? When somebody says, wait, will you wait? No matter how bad you're squirming around, will you stick and stay? Will it fear, face everything and recover, or forget everything and run? It says, bearing fruit in each season, their leaves will not wither, you will get stronger. Yes, you are doing good, but you can be even better. Can you imagine your life never withering? Getting better and better, as my bishop says, good and better. And they prosper in all they do. That's the 12th step of AA. Practice these principles in all your affairs. If you do that, you will prosper in everything you do. You've got a challenge, you've got a circumstance you don't like, you can still prosper in it. You don't have to talk about your circumstance, you can talk to your circumstance. I don't want to hear about your problem, I want you to talk to your problem and say, you ain't going to affect me, you got to move out of the way. I've been called by God, I was a drug addict, I walked away from crack cocaine. This is nothing, this is no problem than it was on the streets for me, not knowing if I was going to live another day because of my addiction. That was tough. This is nothing. But we're hard in our addiction and we're wimps in our recovery. If you don't work a program, if you're afraid to work a program, let me tell you something, people, you'll get put to work in a relapse. How much work was it to get one more? How much work was it to tell one more lie? How much work was it to cover up after cover up and cover up? And that's what it's saying in Jeremiah 12:2. Are you merely going through the motions? You have planted them and they have taken root. I got these guys over here that have taken root. These guys doing this parking lot deal, taken root. Smiling every time I see them. That's why they say in AA, the newcomer is the most important person in the meeting. When they first get there, they're planted. But can you stay planted? Can you stay planted after you get a job? Can you stay planted after you get your license back? Can you stay planted when you can see your kids? Can you stay where God put you, even though He's blessing you? Because if you're not planted, everything's at risk. And the funny thing about addiction is you don't even know it. I speak from personal experience, and if we had the time, I could go around the room and tell you about people that went back too early to do that. And what it's saying here is, your name is on their lips. They tell you what you want to hear, but you are far from their hearts. Who knows about your plans other than you? If you're the only one that knows about your bust-a-move plan, you will bust a move every time. It says in Ecclesiastes 3:11, unless you are firmly planted, you will miss what God has for you. Yet everything is made beautiful in its own time. I don't care how old you, the rest of your life can be the best of your life. He has planted eternity in the human heart. Life is precious. But even so, people cannot see the whole scope of God's work from beginning to end. I didn't see a house. I didn't see an apartment building. I didn't see a church. I didn't see all of you. All I saw was my circumstances. All I saw is that I couldn't see my kids. All I saw was my bank account. All I saw that I was a laughing stock in the business community. All I saw that everybody was disappointed in me. But I took it all and put it to the side. And I said, I'm going to do this time. I don't care about all this. I want to get better. How bad do you want to get better? You can tell me you want to get better. I want to see if you want to get better. Can you be challenged? Can you be corrected? Can you be hit where it hurts? Can you do what you don't want to do so you can do what you want to do? Are you going to do what you want to do and then you'll end up doing what you don't want to do? We're in a different season now, residents of Serenity Village. I ask you, if you've been here over 6 months and you're not planted yet, what are you doing here? God has given you every opportunity to get this. Jeremiah 24:6, get planted now or get planted later. It's your choice. See, you don't have to be planted now. You can go back out there and make a mess of your life. And the circumstances that you're having a hard time dealing with now will be doubled when you come back, and you couldn't even deal with what you were planted in the first place. And now you have a mammoth of other circumstances that's going to be difficult. Since you're here, get planted. Because God will always bring you back to where He wants you. I love you. God bless you.